This week on Barbell Shrug, we travel to Mike McGoldrick's house and hang out in his garage gym.
It's hot out there. Bitches ain't walking.
Is that off the new Jay-Z album?
it's the new Jay Diddy.
Jay Diddy.
And P-Fuzz.
Hello, this is Mike Bledsoe here with Barbell Shrug. Doug Larson and I have traveled with CTP down to fabulous Mississippi to visit Mike McGoldrick.
OB.
Mike McGoldrick has basically turned one of his garages into a training facility. So we're going to be talking about how to make your own garage gym. We submitted a bunch of questions, We submitted a question on Facebook asking, if you have any questions in regard to garage gyms, and we got a ton of responses. And what we're going to do is we're going to attempt to answer most of these, and we're going to save a lot of them for the end of the show, just so you know. First, make sure to go to barbellshrug.com, sign up for the newsletter. And obviously, if you followed us on Facebook, you would have seen that we were going to film this show, and you would have been able to submit your own question. But if you didn't like us on Facebook, screw you. So, sorry about that. Episode, what are we on? 71?
71, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
So, we're going to talk about the garage gym, and you like, McGoldrick is now going to be going to the CrossFit Games, so he's like, I got to get serious. So I'm going to stop training in gym so much and train at my house.
I'd imagine a big part of that's like you train at Faction once a day and that's cool, but if you're training doubles and triples, you can't, it's 45 minutes to Faction, you can't travel that three times a day.
Yep.
So you had to just make your own facility.
Yep. And just having the flexibility of being able to train whenever I want to without having to call you guys up or see who's going to be there. And no gym really, unless you own it, is that flexible.
Yeah, Faction's hours really aren't built around people training three times a day.
Yeah.
We're open before and after work, middle of the day, not
exactly.
So much really. We have a noon class, but that's like a more recent thing.
Yep. You could do it, but you'd have to depend solely on Faction's schedule.
Yep. And
it's open three different times.
We have expanded our hours over the years, but still, if you're training three times a day, it's not good. So,
yep.
So tell us a little bit about your gym and kind of what you envisioned and kind of what it turned out to be.
A dream of mine was to always have a home gym at this scale. Nothing like this. I never dreamed of having this much, but I'd always pictured having space to have a car in my garage with a workbench, and then maybe like a pull up rig hanging from the ceiling with a barbell and a squat rack. But we found this house that actually had an entirely separate two-car garage that is at the other end of the house. So we like went nuts and bought the house.
So if you want a garage gym, you have to buy a new house two garages.
No, not the case. But it was just perfect. There's just the house for the size of what it is. You won't find another one that's got an entirely separate two-car garage. This garage was actually an add-on after the house was built. The previous owner, I think she had some extra family move in, and she was going to try and turn it into like some living space, mm-hmm. and just never did. So it's just a garage, a whole separate one sitting on the other side of the house. And when we saw it, we were like, oh, crap. Yeah, we can turn that into a whole gym. Yeah,
having two garages is perfect for you. You got your shop where you can do a lot of your woodworking stuff. You built a ton of stuff that in your house. You built new tables and like little end tables and all kinds of other stuff too.
Yeah,
built some equipment for the gym.
And then stuff in your gym as well.
Yep. Everything worked out. And we can still fit a car in there too. So we are actually using the garage for one car. That's about it.
You talking about here or the other one?
No, the other one.
Who gets to park the car in the garage?
Randy does, because I have a big truck. So.
You can park a car in here, though. Just move some of the stuff out of the way.
Oh, we could, yeah. But
you got plenty of room. No need to, I guess.
No interest in putting a car in here. This isn't a garage. This is a gym.
Okay.
I like it.
Yeah, so that works out pretty well that you happen to be pretty good at woodworking. Like, you made that sweet box right there, which is pretty novel. It can fold, like, a couple different ways. How many different heights do you have on it?
Yeah, that's I saw the picture of it online. I haven't found plans for it. I might make some, and I'm sure there's a couple of companies that have started making them. But it's like a four-sided box. I mean, it's a four... it's got four different dimensions to jump on. Sorry. There's more than four sides. It's a 36 inch, a 30, a 24, and an 18. And you can flip it whichever way you want. All with, I think it was like a piece of 4x8 plywood and then a 4x4 piece of plywood. So not that much lumber. Just you just got to be able you got to have something that you can cut the plywood straight. But it's pretty easy to make. It's just, you know, cut the wood straight and nail it in.
Yeah.
Aside from being super heavy, which might be a kind of a pain in the ass at a big gym, you got a haul box, you know, 40 yards across the room. It's pretty awesome to have.
Yeah, you know, in a regular gym setting, it's probably not ideal. But in here, we only need one, and there's not five people jumping at one time. So, you know, my girlfriend and I, we share it. You know, if you want, it flips down. You can see on the side, the largest side that flips down, that's the 24-inch side. So two or three people could jump on that at once. Mm-hmm. It is heavy to move around, but like I said, you know, I'm not using it every day. So moving it once or twice a week is not a big deal.
Yeah, and if you're listening to this podcast, you might want to tune into the video because there's going to be a lot of footage for this particular episode looking at Mike's gym and some of the things that he did that was pretty unique to work around some issues you might have. So the fortunate thing for Mike is he's really handy. When I envision a gym for myself, I'm like squat rack, bar bumpers, and a set of rings. And then when I look at my ceiling, I'm like, how am I going to do the rings? I have no idea because I am the opposite of handy. So I'm, in my opinion, I'm like, I'll just buy everything. But with you, you were like, well, I think I'll just build this thing. And I'm going, why don't you just buy that and then have it shipped to your house? Like, to me, it just seems like a big waste of time to build it. But for you, I think you might get a little bit of pleasure out of making that stuff. And you built a lot of things. What have you built in here?
Oh, absolutely. I built the box. I put up the handstand push-up support. Now, that I did that because you see most gyms have, like, whiteboard or they just slap a piece of plywood on the wall, and that wears out over time. We actually put, like, 2x6 supports behind it into the studs. So, like, I mean, you could run up and drop kick it, and it's not going to do anything.
Have you tried that?
No, I haven't. When the games are over, I'm going to start.
Can I try it after this episode?
Yeah, absolutely. I got some padding there for you.
I'll need that.
You created the window of opportunity.
I did. I built a window of opportunity.
Oh, yeah. Check that out.
Everyone should have
Very
their own.
Very clever. You texted me a picture the other day.
I haven't built anything extraordinary yet, like the box and the parallettes. You know, certain things I didn't want to build because of how much I use them, like the squat rack and pull-up rigs. Like, I don't really want to build that because I'm swinging my body off that. So I wanted something pretty sturdy. And Rogue, I mean, this is a Rogue rig. Like, for the money, it's absolutely worth it because I can always take this down or I can add on to it. It's not specially made for me, but I can take it down, like I said, and add on to it. Or if I ever move one day, like, it comes apart real easy.
And you didn't go with just the squat rack. I mean, you've got the squat rack plus another 6 feet for that spiel bar.
Yeah, I mean, actually, I did. It's just a basic. It's called the W4, which is a 4-foot wall mount, meaning it's 4 feet wide. So it comes with two uprights and then 2 6-foot wall supports. And then from there, I just bought another bar so I could kind of throw into the corner and have a spot for my muscle-ups as
right.
well.
Yeah, and that's something I wouldn't do in my garage because I use mine to park vehicles in as
right.
well. And I personally would want to go with something like just
movable
H-stands.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, they have so many options. One of the cool – if you're limited on space, one of the coolest things I saw was the yokes that they have now. Some of them have extensions or attachments you can put on to have a pull-up bar on it.
Oh,
so you just leave the weights on the bottom of the yoke, and then you can do your pull-ups. So that's like a – I think that's a – that's like the middle of the three options you have for a yoke.
Taller one,
you can get a taller one. Scoot that section up, and it'll have a pull-up bar on it and do pull-ups on it. So, I mean
– Oh, yeah, that's perfect.
And then, like, then that's a squat
that.
Rack. I mean, it's a sled. It's like so many things in one. Super convenient, you know. So, like – but, like – you know, a lot of this is overkill than for what someone who's just trying to maintain fitness training once a day, but I'm in here two or three times a day, you know, 6 days a week. Like, I wanted everything, so.
You also got some stuff that a lot of gyms don't have, like adjustable dumbbells. Do you ever use those?
Yes, I do. I didn't necessarily want an entire rack of dumbbells, so I actually bought those from you guys. It was an extra set you had. They're power racks. They work fine for doing, you know, dumbbell cleans or dumbbell thrusters. Like I said, I'm only using them once or twice a week, so that was a much better option than buying a full set of dumbbells.
Yeah, power blocks are nice to have, but you can't use them in a class setting so much. But right. If you're training on your own for like a home gym, like yeah. When I get my own home gym, I'm definitely going to get a set of power
yeah,
blocks.
Yeah, way better than having a whole rack because, I mean, it just doesn't take up any space. And like, I snatch with them and stuff. Like, you can throw them around. Like, they're plenty sturdy. They're fine.
Yeah.
It doesn't look like it, but they are.
Yeah, we were pretty lucky that we ended up having two of those for almost nothing. We almost got them for free.
Yeah.
We actually got... Funny story, we almost had three of them, and then someone basically stole it from us right before we went to go pick them up.
Oh, that's right. Wasn't someone in there taking stuff?
Yeah, we had bought those from a business that had gone out of business, and right before we went to go pick them up, we were like out looking at the business from a distance, and the old employees had heard that we had bought all the stuff, and they went there to collect everything before we got to go inside to see what was actually in there, and they took one of the sets of power blocks.
We called
the CEO, and he was like, they're not supposed to be there right now. And
oh,
so
wow.
we went over there, and we're like, oh, thanks for opening it up for us, guys. And they were like, son of a bitch.
Yeah.
They were super pissed that it got caught.
It was shady. I thought we were about to throw down.
Yeah.
I was like, man, these guys... Or you could tell they were not happy that
those
we had just
my dumbbells. My yeah. dumbbells.
Yeah. Quick note on that. Yeah, I think we scored between $20,000 and $30,000 of equipment for $500.
$500.
And the only reason
and you sold those to me.
hey, yeah. I'm not a businessman. All right.
Obviously, you are.
Oh wait.
You are a businessman.
What am I saying?
Yes,
I tricked you, see?
Oh, man.
It's called profit.
No, but
I will refer you to the last episode where we talked about business. Adding to our credibility.
Yeah, it was really fortunate, but I think that he actually gave us that deal at such a good price because I think there were some other things going on and he was talking to some other people that had just pissed him off.
All right.
And he was like, that was his way of saying, you know, F you to some other people. And we just happened to be nice.
Yeah.
We just, you know, the interaction we had with the guy was very, you know, cordial and non-confrontational. I think there were some other interactions he had with some other gyms in the area where they didn't get along nearly as well.
Right.
So being nice... can go a long way. Read, what's the name of that book? How to Win Friends and Influence People.
Yep.
It works.
Mm-hmm. It was a good book.
Got
some chalkboard paint, too. That's a must-have in a garage gym.
Yeah, you can buy that stuff at Lowe's. It's like $20 a can or something. I can't remember exactly.
I think it's $16 a quart.
Yeah, I used two of the small quarts, two of them, and I doubled it up, and like it was plenty.
How many did you do, one or two coats?
Two cans, two coats.
Two coats.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, it took me a couple hours to throw it up, and you can just have fun with it, write stuff up there. And I don't want whiteboard because it just gets dirty and it falls apart after a while, starts warping. And
oh, yeah. Well, this looks good. And you've named your gym.
I did. Manifest Fitness.
It's legit.
Thank you.
I really like that name.
Thank you.
I like how you got it chalked up there, too.
The Shepherd actually drew that. He came out last Saturday.
Really?
Yeah.
Very nice.
Yeah.
You want to hit some questions?
Let's do it.
Dun, dun,
I think
dun.
That's the most interesting part of the whole day.
Yeah, probably. So how to sell the idea to the wife? You're not married, so.
I'm not, but I have a girlfriend, and I'm not.
Don't
actually,
tell everybody that.
I'm not even like in a good position to talk about this because she trains too, so I didn't have to sell her anything.
She's a regional
competitor. She was like, can I split it with you?
So, that's perfect.
Yeah.
You're in the ideal setting. There.
I think as long as you can convince the wife that she can still park her vehicle in the garage, that's the way into that. If you make it where your wife has to park outside, that's where you're going to hit some problems. I think.
You know that, and talk about how much more time you'll spend at home. Whereas you get off work, you get to come. You come straight home
to her needs. Nice.
Yeah, I mean, you're doing it for her.
Make it about.
It's all about her. And so
you're a great guy.
You're getting off work. You know, either, what was that?
I don't know.
All right, anyways, so either you say you train in the morning, you know, you get up early, you're out the door, and then you don't have to go to the gym after work. You know, you've already got your training done and you can save time to go to work. Or if you train after work, you get off work, you come home and you train, and you know, you save an hour and a half from having to drive to and from a gym. Or
that, and you might save money in the long run.
Oh, you definitely will. Like, it, you know, most memberships now are $200 plus.
Yep.
You know, you can pretty much build a gym for a couple grand. So.
Just don't tell people that. All of our members will start building their own facilities in the garages. We'll have no members.
Not everyone has two-car garages.
That's right. Let's see. Next question. What kind of things can you do to compensate for low ceiling? Things like wall ball, muscle-ups are impossible for me in my garage. Well, let's look at McGee.
You got the most legit answer out there.
Well, yeah, look at this. Your ceiling is incredible.
Ceilings are actually, like, medium height. Like, I think they're just under 10 feet, but they're still not high enough to do things like muscle-ups or bar muscle-ups. You can't press out on anything.
Right.
So we cut out the drywall. Now, I wouldn't recommend you doing that yourself. Have someone come out and take a look at it structurally and see what they can remove. But really, all we did was box this out and hang the rings 2 or 3 feet higher. I think I measured the height of where to hang the rings at 12 feet because that's what most of the like the wall mount rigs are, like what you have at Faction.
Oh, what you might see at the games.
Yeah, well, the games was 15, but that wasn't an option here. But 12
right.
is what I did, and it's plenty of space. I mean,
yeah.
But
did that yourself, or you had someone come help you?
I had some guys come out and help me cut out do the boxing out.
Like professional contractors, or you just had some friends and knew how to do it?
No, I didn't hire a company. It's a guy who lives around the corner who owns his own business, and he just came over on his own time and helped me with it.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah,
that's
nice. Kind of did it on the side.
What? How'd you figure out how to, like, lay this out? Like, what made you decide to stick this in this corner? I mean, did you sit and, like, analyze it and try to save space?
Hell yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that's what I do. Before I can do anything, like build anything, I have to draw it.
Did you put it in CAD?
Yes, I did. It was definitely an AutoCAD.
McGee's a nerd.
And I had to sketch it up, and I wanted to, like, utilize as much space as possible, but also get as many pieces of equipment in here as possible.
That's key for building a gym. A computer-drafted model is essential.
Absolutely. No, I mean, that's just how, I mean, like.
I did mine on notebook paper. Mine's a business.
That's right.
I mean, I drew everything. I drew, like, where the mops were going to go on the wall, like, everything. And it just helps me lay things out to see better because Rogue has so many options online on little rigs and stuff
on
you
the
can
wall.
Buy. Yep, that's where I drew them. And so what was the – where were we at? Sorry, I got distracted.
Just how you decide to –
how'd you plan the layout?
Yeah. So I started with, like, the main things I need to do. Like, what's the most important thing to have? Like, a squat rack and pull-ups.
Right.
Right? So I was like, all right, where's the rig going to go? And I just started off with the corner. And then I thought about, all right, what little additions do I want? I want to be able to do, like, ring dips on it. So I thought, okay, well, I'll need an extended rig. So I – had the wall mount. All right. Well,
you'll
I
need the 6 feet.
Right. I want to do
there's a 4 foot version.
Right.
Yeah.
I want to do bar muscle ups too. So I looked at areas about hanging a bar, and I thought, no, like the more simple I can do it, like keep it, the better. So I saw that Rogue had the spiel bar that literally just goes on the side of this, and I actually have never seen any rigs set up like this in a corner. So I actually called and asked them if I could do this, and they're like, I mean, sure. It's all compatible. So.
You can do whatever you want.
Yep. So.
And how did you bolt that in the ground? Did you, like, put a platform down, or did you just go right in the concrete?
The rig.
Yes.
Hammer drilled into the concrete.
Okay.
With concrete anchors.
Cool.
Yeah. So, I mean, me and two of us put this up. It was really easy.
Yeah.
And then, I just kind of added as I went. Like, a lot of stuff I already had. I already had some weights and bumpers and, some barbells and the rower and the Airdyne and, That's actually the expensive stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah, the machines are. Some iron?
Yeah, the iron's cheap. You know, you can probably find people trying to give that stuff away.
In Memphis.
We pretty much were trying
Faction.
To give it away.
Yeah.
It might be harder to come by in other towns, Mike. It just seems like we were trying to get rid of it.
The yoke I bought because I needed a sled. I needed another squat rack and, the yoke as well. So, I was going to get an addition on it where you can do pull-ups on it, but I didn't really have a need. We have, like, 6 pull-up bars here. So.
Yeah.
How your neighbor's going to know how strong you are if you don't front squat in the driveway.
I was walking. I had 600 pounds on it the other day doing a workout.
Oh, yeah?
And I was walking up down the street. And there's a bunch of construction workers out here working on houses. And they were like...
they talk to you?
No.
They never talked to me.
No one stopped by and said hi yet.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I'm out here every day, garage open.
Well, people
music
are
going.
Fucking intimidated, man.
There's nothing intimidating about me on an air diamond.
Yeah, there is. Because most people don't exercise at all.
Like,
and then you got you, like, one of the fittest people in the world, like, just going nuts with your shirt off. I'm sure they're like, you're probably way more intimidating than you think you are.
It says when you air down, you always get on the ground and roll around like you're dying afterwards. So they're probably like, did you see that guy?
Diablo.
That's right. All right, what do we got next?
Lifting platform. Construction, best material, styles, and their benefits. Weighted frame or bolted to the floor. And if you look around this room right here, there's no platform at all. You do it all on the rubber. Do you miss not having like a wooden platform at all?
No, not at all. The flat rubber I bought separately than what's textured here. It's a little bit more expensive buying the individual pieces, but it works just fine. I mean,
right.
I'm not an Olympic weightlifter. I don't do it every single day.
Right.
But I do lift heavy a lot, and when it comes time to find the 1RMs and stuff like that, like, this works perfectly fine for me. It's no different from when it used to be at the gym. And I've lifted on platforms. Like, you guys had some of those platforms at the gym, and, like, I mean, it really is no difference to me.
Yeah, I actually find myself not lift. Sometimes I lift on rubber. Sometimes I lift on platforms.
Yeah.
I probably at my own, like, if I ever do a garage gym at my house, which I'm sure I'll do eventually, I don't foresee putting a platform in there because it just – it takes up a lot of space.
It does. I mean, unless you build it somehow flush into the ground with everything, having the wood,
right?
It's just more headache than needed, you know?
Who knows? Maybe a year from now, I'll have, like, four platforms in one room.
Yeah.
And I'll be taking back what I'm saying now.
Yeah, you definitely don't need it in the garage. I like lifting on the platform at the gym because it's, like, this designated space where I know nobody's going to be within a certain amount of feet from me.
Yeah, but
get out of my way.
That's right. Leave me alone.
I mean, if you're just weightlifting in a garage and you're never putting a car in it, sure. But if you're trying to do CrossFit and have space for other stuff, then no, it's not really ideal. Rubber matting.
DIY versus pre-made. What is better to buy and what is better to make yourself? I think we kind of touched on that a little bit. You made your own box for jumping on. You're building your own jerk box.
Yes, I'm building my own jerk box. And this goes back to if you're handy or not, if you have the tools. Like,
you will never
if you've
catch
never,
me to attempt
if
that.
You've never even built a box, I wouldn't recommend trying to build your own jerk blocks.
Because
one, I mean, they need to be strong and sturdy and safe. And you know, if you don't have any background in that or any experience, you're just going to spend – you're probably spending as much money ordering them.
I've gone through jerk blocks before, and I've seen other people build them.
Yeah.
And not only does it have to be extremely durable – like, don't use wood screws. Use lag screws all the way around.
Yep.
But the other thing is it also the precision necessary to have to build something that you have to be able to move around. So it has to be, like, just as precise as it is durable, which it's hard to accomplish both of those things.
Yeah,
especially with something you're going to take apart and then put back together and take apart again and put back together
and drop
again
300 pounds on repeatedly.
And each section is going to change spots in the order and all that. Like, to have all that put in place where it's going to work every time and last for years is probably tougher than
you
think.
Look, if you're on an extremely tight budget, like I had to pull from blocks
the other day.
I just stacked up iron plates and pulled from them.
Right.
And then when I got the weight overhead, I just walked forward and then dropped it. So, I mean, there's makeshift ways to do it. Now, jerk blocks, you probably couldn't – you don't want to do that. You have, like, 6 feet of plates, you know. But, you know, like,
someone's
going
to die tomorrow.
For
I
pulling
heard it on
stuff,
the podcast. It was totally safe.
Yeah. For pulling, there's ways to work around it. But jerk blocks, I haven't seen many options other than either building your own or just spending the money. And, like, there's a ton of places to buy them online now.
Does Rogue have any scoops that are adjustable that go on the rigs that you can drop onto? I don't know. We used to have those.
Not that
for,
I know of.
I used to have those growing up that were adjustable that went on like a big half rack.
Something you could drop on?
Yeah, something you could drop on. They're big. They're big. We call them scoops. I don't know what they're called, but they're super heavy. They're about this wide and about this long, and they have a little bit of a divot, and we could just put them on our half rack. Not like a Rogue.
You drop the plates on it?
The bumpers hit it.
Yeah.
The bar doesn't hit it.
Yeah.
They drop the bumpers on it.
Yeah, say that would tear up the bar. Yeah. Huh. No, I've never seen that. Cool.
I'll find a picture of it and I'll put it on.
Oh, is it like a plate?
It's a big metal plate that sticks out.
I think
out
I've seen
a
picture of that somewhere, but yeah, I don't think Rogue has this. Huh. Rogue, you must make those.
I'll try to get a picture from Mark's gym, and I'll edit it into the footage.
Yeah, dude, if I could attach something to a rig, even say if it was inside, I don't know, somehow where I could do jerks and it was detachable, that would be a game changer for sure. Because right now we have big, giant blocks that we have to, like, move around, and the girls have a hard time moving them around.
Yeah, what are the scoops called that the bar sits on that we have that we tie the bands to and whatnot? That you can do rack pulls from, but you can't really drop on it. You can't drop on it.
They're good for like rack pulls, but you're not gonna, you don't want to drop a good bar
on
it.
It's probably just
velocity.
A safety rack. I mean, it's just a removable safety rack.
I think that might be what it's called.
It's basically what it is. I don't know what the actual name is on Rogue's site though.
You got a computer in front of you.
I know. I'm taking show notes.
Oh, is that what you're doing?
Do you think I was just surfing the web?
Next question.
All right, we'll take a break real quick. Oh, before we go, I want to let the world know that I am friends with Adele Bagzik. Later, buddy.
Now they know.
You always got to believe that you can do it. I tell that to people. It might not happen today. It might not happen this week. It might not happen next week. It might not even happen next year. But if you believe that it'll happen, you can do it. It will happen. It will. I know it will. I might not be the fastest. I might not be the most gymnasty out there, but I'll tell you what, I'm never going to stop. Ever stop believing in what I can do. No one can take that away from me.
All right, welcome back to Technique Quad. Today we're going to talk about deck squats, both single leg and double leg. So if you've never seen a deck squat, here's what it looks like. Put my feet together, I squat all the way down, I roll back, usually I push on the ground, and then I stand back up. You can also do that with a single leg, so I fall down, and then I basically do a pistol out of it. So that's just like pistols, those are very hard movements to do. Mobility-wise, I have to have a lot of ankle range of motion, so with my feet together, I should be able to squat down all the way to the very, very, very bottom, because that's the only way that I'm gonna be able to get all the way to the bottom back up. If I can only squat this low, there's no way I'm gonna be able to roll to this position here, okay? With my feet out in front of me like that, I'm just gonna end up posting my feet too far out in front of me and falling back down. It's gonna be very frustrating. So, number one is having enough mobility to be able to do this movement. The other thing is having enough of a counterbalance to get up. So if you're a heavier person, then it's gonna be very hard to roll forward. You're gonna have to roll very hard. Another easy way to get yourself all the way up on your feet is to have a weight that you can throw, or I can come back like this. I can throw the weight forward and it'll pull me forward. So nice to have a little bit of momentum to help carry you up. A few little fine details. When I'm right here, my heels are all the way under me. I need to be able to be in that same position on the way up. I need to be able to roll up like this. So like I said, if your heels come out here, it's gonna be super tough. So usually what I do is I go like this, and then I throw my heels right under me. That way I can just roll up. Like that. So if you don't have full knee flexion where you can get into this position, then again, that's another thing that you need to take care of. So here's what a fast series of deck squats look like. I come down, pull myself up, and then pull myself up, okay? Another way that you can scale deck squats is to be on a ramp. So I'm here, and then the ramp makes it much easier to get up. The other way you can scale is just to sit down on something. So I can be here, I can roll back, and then I can stand back up. So if you have bad ankle mobility, that's another way you can do it. You know, you don't have to do it on concrete or a metal ramp. You can put a mat down if it's killing you. But a ramp and sitting down on something make it much easier to start doing deck squats if deck squats are difficult for you. Using the ramp or some type of elevated surface is an especially good idea if you're a person that wants to transition from the two-legged deck squat onto the one-legged deck squat. It's basically just a variation of pistols. So again, I could be here, I could roll back onto something, and then it just makes that pistol easier to do, and then I can work my way down towards the ground as I get better and better and better, as my mobility and as my strength improves. So if you're wondering why you would ever want to do deck squats, well, that's one of the reasons. It's just one way to scale or to vary learning how to do pistols correctly. It makes it a little bit more dynamic. So if you're ever on the ground, it's just a fast way to get up off the ground. We're all about functional movement, and getting up off the ground is one of the most functional things you could do.
2-1, shrug time.
Doo-doo. Welcome back to Barbell Shrugged. I'm Mike Bledsoe here at McGoldrick's. I almost want to say McGoldrick's cabin.
We're not at the cabin right now.
We're at his. It felt like we had to drive so far. It felt like we were at your cabin. So, Doug Larson came down. CTP's obviously here filming again. And want to bring this up real quick because it is extremely pertinent since we're talking about garage gyms. We just launched the other day something called Movement Mastery. It's basically something we were thinking about, a problem that a lot of people have, and especially people that have garage gyms, because they don't have a coach watching them all the time. And also the other problem might be that you're a coach and maybe you're the best guy in the gym and you need some help maybe analyzing some lifts with maybe some of your clients and stuff like that. So we created a solution to that problem, which is we're calling it Movement Mastery, which is a program that we put together that basically takes a lot of the technique wad stuff that we've done and it packages it together, and you'll get access to a page on barbellshrug.com where it categorizes all the movements that we go over in technique wads, and there's actually a progression in there as well. It's listed in progression, so it's easy to find. I think the thing that makes the program so valuable is you get access to a secret Facebook group where...
Secret.
It's secret. It's a secret Facebook group if you join the program, and you'll get access to that group and can post videos of your technique or the technique of, say, somebody you're training. And then Doug, myself, Chris Moore, a couple of the coaches from Faction, we've got the coaches in on this as well. And what we'll do is we'll kind of tell you what drill, say you're needing help on a snatch or something like that. We see that you're having this particular problem. Not only will we just kind of tell you what your problem is, but we'll assign some like drills you can do. You know, if we notice that something in particular isn't happening that's supposed to happen with the snatch, we'll say, hey, you should check out this video and you should do that drill, you know, every time you warm up, or you should incorporate in this in your training somehow or something like this. And this is a really good program. This allows you to follow any blog programming that you want, or if somebody is writing a program specifically for you or you're programming for yourself, you obviously might have the programming aspect handled somewhere. But what we're going to do is handle just the movement side of things. So I'm really excited about the program. Doug and I have been kind of putting it together this week, mainly Doug putting it together, me talking about it. he's like, yep. But, anything you want to add to that, Doug?
No, that pretty much covers it. We do the same thing with the six-month muscle gain challenge, guys, and they've gotten a lot of value out of being able to submit videos and get very specific feedback. So if you don't have a coach, then this is perfect because you can get some online coaching for relatively cheap. It's $99 for 3 months in that program. The movement library will be constantly updated. We just filmed a ton of mobility videos the other day, and that's the next thing that I'm going to put into the movement library. So right now everyone emails me and they say, oh, I wish you guys had a video on this. And I'd be like, well, we have like four videos on that. So yeah. they're not easy enough to find on the blog because you have to sift through one video at a time. So it's just nice to have everything categorized on one single page where it says snatch video, technique quad 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 on snatches and on. Enough about that. I think we got the point. Check out Movement Mastery.
I'm so excited. I want to keep talking about it. Come on, Doug. Let me talk about it more.
There's Doug's natural segue.
I think it's fitter.tv.
You need to butter that up better.
fitter.tv/product/movement, I believe, is the page if you want to check that out. There's a little video on there that explains it. All right, more questions.
All right. Doug, you picked this question out. I thought it was really good.
Yeah.
It was the, if you could purchase three things, what would the first three items be? If you were going to do a garage gym and you could only purchase three, what would be your first three items, Mike?
Airdyne.
Okay. That's one. Good counter.
The barbell and plates count as one?
Yeah, sure. Like a barbell set, yeah.
Okay, so
Airdyne. You're not going to do something with a barbell without plates. Come on now.
I'm just making sure. I didn't want like clips to be one thing. Barbell, plates, and clips. That's two. And pull-up bar.
Okay. First three things. How about you, Doug? Does it vary for you at all?
No, barbell bumpers is definitely the easy one. I probably wouldn't do an Airdyne personally first. I'd probably go with rings and a rig. Yeah, Rogue Rig. Rogue Rig, rings, barbell set.
Damn,
did I steal yours?
Pretty close.
Wait, what was yours?
Wait. Rogue Rig counts as a squat rack, pull-up bar. I want to use that one.
I
said pull-up bar.
I win. what's yours?
Look, considering my current situation with my garage, I wouldn't do a Rogue Rig just because it takes up a lot of space. So I would want the convenience of just some H-stands. So I would go with the H-stands, you know, very, very mobile. I also don't slam my bar into a rack like an asshole, so I know how to properly set things into a rack. I might be sending a message to some people in the gym. I don't know.
You heathen.
So, yeah, you're not an animal. You're a human being. Set your rack. Set your bar into the rack. No, anyways. Yeah, I would do H-stands and then a barbell set, probably Worksen or an Alico set, you know. And then
or you could replace the Worksen set and buy an entire gym.
I'm trying to get Worksen to send me something,
sorry,
Mike.
Sorry.
I don't think Worksen would appreciate that.
Sorry. Yeah. Not the saying it's not great. They're awesome.
It's my favorite barbell.
Yeah.
Right, and then
they are very nice barbells.
For sure.
Yeah, the rings would be my last thing. So, I don't know. All right. Quick quiz. If you get a fourth thing, what would it be? Go.
Parallettes.
Go.
An L-box or whatever you want to call that. No, that's not true.
I just named what I saw. I don't like pressure yet.
Personally, actually, I'd probably get a safety bar.
Yeah. The guy who is going to the CrossFit Games doesn't like pressure.
That's right.
This is not a good sign.
Actually, speaking of barbells, what kind of barbells did you get? There's lots of variety that Rogue offers. Which one did you pick up?
Too much variety.
My girlfriend's got the Rogue female bar. I think it's the Rogue bar. I don't know.
Bella bar.
Yeah.
I know what bar
she already had that one. Her friends actually bought her that one, so that was already here. I bought a crappy old bar from you guys. Not really crappy, but it's not nice by any means.
Yeah.
And then I bought the Rogue Ohio bar. I'm a big fan of it. I do most of the weightlifting with it. It's got good knurling. Feels nice.
Feels pretty good. I hadn't used that one before.
It's blacked out. It looks cool.
Looking cool is the most important thing.
It was. That's really why I bought it.
All right, Mike, what else we got?
I don't know. I'm looking for something good. Banded lifting platforms.
What kind of plates?
Man. Oh, plates?
Oh, yeah.
I would go just bumpers all the way. Works on bumpers or Alico.
You bought the black ones because they were cheaper?
Yes, I did. I bought those bumpers. They have the Rogue, they have the competition plates, and then they have like the, I think those are the lower end, like those are like the high temp bumpers.
No, the high temp ones are made from like that.
Those
that
are high,
rubber.
Those are high temps over there.
Well,
like the used
thick rubber
tire ones.
I don't know.
You don't really. I don't feel like you see those much anymore. But I went with these just because they're extremely economical. Like they,
right.
You could get. I got an entire set of those for like $400 or $500, I think.
Yeah, with the bar and bumper, you're really going to get what you pay for.
Yeah.
Like, if you buy a high-priced bumper, it's going to last for a long time.
Right. And here's the thing. Like, you need high-quality bumpers in a gym because you have weightlifters using it every day, like
right.
several times a day. Like, I mean, I use mine every day, but not as much as a gym would use it. So
way to justify being cheap, Mike.
These may wear out quicker in a gym setting, but these are going to last me a very long time.
Yeah, our bumpers at our facility are
going to
be used 6 times a day.
Those are the HG Rogue bumpers.
Yeah, that's right. And like, you know, like the only thing I'm worried about is like the 10s and 15s, but I'm not going to drop from overhead like fundamentals classes do.
Right.
You know, like just drop wearing out the 10s and 15s.
Yeah, that's the other thing is like don't put 10-pound, in my opinion, 10-pound bumpers shouldn't be dropped ever. Even if you have like 45s and then 10s on the outside, because 10-pound bumpers, man, they just wear out so fast.
Yep.
There's no way around it, really. But
so if there's a 10 on the outside, never drop it?
No, I wouldn't even put – I would put iron on there.
Gotcha.
I'd put a 10-pound iron on there. That's what belongs on there.
Duh.
Well, what's the bumper for then?
It's for people who can't lift more than 10 pounds on each side. And I don't know what it's for.
He's like, oh,
I'm just messing
with about that.
People want them. I don't know.
No, it's I know what you mean. Like
if it were 100% up to me, we probably wouldn't even have them.
Well, most people that aren't strong enough to like clean it and to drop it, they're usually so timid anyways that they kind of like set it down.
Right, yeah.
It's the assholes who are doing like, you know,
ghost ride the bar.
Yeah,
it's
they're like into their Metcon and they throw it and they take five steps back. Like, that's me.
By the way, the thinner the plate, the more likely that bar when you ghost ride it is just going to scoot across the floor and hit your friend.
Oof.
So don't do that. Yeah, the good question here was the banded lifting platforms. One of the things we've done in the past is I just go to Lowe's and I buy some like shower handles. And if you're going to do a banded, if you want to set up something to band your squats or something, you might need to do like a plywood platform. It makes it where you can screw something up and not be the end of the world. Otherwise, you're going to go into concrete. But I know that we did at Chris Moore's gym. And what we did, I've done this a few times, is build the wood platform for the squat rack, and then you just bolt the wood down. I know there's some squat racks, like the old Elite Fitness rack that we have. You don't need handles or anything extra to hook a band to it, just because it's got little a rack going along the bottom, and you can use bands with that.
Yeah. What about
most CrossFitters probably don't need to be doing a lot of banded stuff. There's a lot of variation in your training already.
I feel like I've seen a couple of variations too. Some people stepping on the band with it connected to the bar and doing a deadlift like that.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah.
Or using dumbbells from a squat rack.
Yeah.
Like 100-pound dumbbells.
If you follow my Instagram or Vine, you've probably seen
saying that. Is that a no-no or does that work fine?
No. I've actually been doing that. Like, you'll see some creative ways to do bands.
Yeah.
If you like were following my Instagram or Vine, then you'll see that. You did it. Chris Moore did one.
Me and you did one.
We did one.
We
did.
We did a daily BS on this.
On how to set up for
bands. Oh yeah. Well, we did it on banded deadlifts. Yeah. But you wouldn't want to set up that way for squats. Yes, right. we did a daily BS on that. You can go to the website and check that out.
We've been using lately I couldn't remember what they were called before the break, but they're called safety spotter arms.
We mount them, we put them all upside down and all the way as close to the ground as we can get them.
Yeah, put them at the bottom, and then we just tie the bands around the safety spotter arms right out of the rig.
And you also need to, you can't just loop it underneath. You might have to double it or something like that because those bands will be just, if you get to the bottom of the squat, there's going to be too much slack in it. So you got to, like, I think I looped it four times the other day.
Yeah, we use one of the smallest bands and then loop it multiple times.
How'd you get hurt? I was banded squatting with the safety squat arms. Doing something unsafe.
Here's the thing.
Like the safety bar is the least safe bar in the gym.
Yeah,
you can't get out.
Yeah,
I was
going
to say that. It's like in the strength and conditioning world, if there's the word safety attached to any piece of equipment, watch out.
Yeah.
You're about to get hurt for sure. A lot of people are asking about like the DIY versus just buying. And I think it's just personal preference, how handy you are. I personally get zero satisfaction out of building things. So like I'm quick to buy because I know that if I'm like, I'm going to build that box, 4 days later I'll be standing there scratching my head and I'll just be pissed off. And I should have just gone to a website and purchased that thing. So,
I'm much more likely to pay for it than try to make some.
One of the things I'm going to buy when I do my home gym eventually is I'm going to get the muscle driver jerk blocks, the adjustable. Those look legit.
Doug, there's a website, if you can pull it up. I don't remember the name of it, but it's like a do-it-yourself home gym website, and it's got plans for like 30 different things you can use. It'd be cool to reference that.
What website is it?
I don't remember the name of it, but they have good plans for like parallettes and simple plyo boxes and like homemade squat racks out of like 4x4 posts. Like really cool stuff if you're like literally on a $100 budget to build a gym.
I'll see if I can find it.
Yeah. How little space do you think you could get away with in a garage? Do you think you could like still park your car in here?
You could realistically get by with a quarter of the space I have in here.
I mean,
even if say everything had to fit in the rig, like I could back everything into it. I could squat, I could lift. I mean, I could lift in it, and you could do a lot. And you know, I'd say 12x12.
Cool. Yeah. And people are asking about different companies. I mean, we could sit and promote a company, but you know, until one sponsors me, I'm not gonna like overtly say anything.
Even though we've been talking about Rogue all day.
We've
already kind of done that.
They're the easy choice.
It's tough because Rogue does make like some of the best stuff out there, and it's
Definitely.
You know, it's what's in our gym. It's what's in your garage. So.
One person says, "When safety when squatting or benching alone without a squat rack. What do you do? What do you do for squatting safely?" I feel like I'm giving you a softball question.
I don't know. I mean, no. squat. If I know that if it's a weight that I might miss, I'm prepared to throw it off of my back and jump forward.
Just drop it on the ground.
Yeah, just, use the bumpers.
Squat
I
like
mean,
a
who,
weightlifter.
Who gives a shit what kind of plates they are? You should be worried about yourself anyway. So irons, you know, whatever you're squatting with doesn't matter. Like, just know that it's okay to drop it on the ground and save yourself. So.
Yeah, if you've been lifting for a long time, front squat, back squat, yeah, either one doesn't matter. If you can't get it, you just step out and it falls on the ground. No big deal. Yeah.
Well, I think the piece of equipment you were just mentioning, too, is whatever it was called.
Those safety spotter arms.
Yeah, we use them for the banded. We make a piece of equipment for safety and make it very unsafe.
Yeah.
But, you could set those up to, close to, just an inch or two underneath your end range of motion at the bottom. And if you get stuck at the bottom, or even if you get stuck halfway up, you just let it down nice and easy, and you shouldn't do any major damage to your bar, and you can just set it down in there. I know I think we're going to try and podcast with Chris Moore in his garage next. And he's got a cool setup, too, which you could actually do here as well, the way you have it set up, but it has really heavy duty straps.
Mm-hmm.
That are hanging,
right? Yeah, I've seen
and
that.
So and that's another option. I mean, now if you'd completely just, drop it, you could probably mess up, something at all, but you should never miss a weight that badly unless you're just doing something.
Right, you unrack it, you're just like a sack of bricks.
Yeah, you made a mistake in loading or something.
Yeah.
But
Rogue does have a strap safety system, which is similar to what Chris Moore has.
Oh, I've seen that. That looks interesting.
Cool.
Or it's a big piece of fabric that catches the bar.
All right, I think we're about ready to wrap this up.
Well, I was going to tell a story about Rogue real quick.
Okay.
I took a picture of the gym, and after I had everything set up, and was real excited about it, and sent them an email, and was like, all my stuff's done. My dream home gym. Thank you so much for having such a cool product. Here's a picture of my home gym. And I don't know what I was expecting. I really wasn't expecting anything. I just wanted to kind of share it with them. But I still felt like mine was, special.
Right.
And
other people don't do this every day.
I know. No, here's the thing. So I get an email back, and it's I don't remember the lady's name, but she's like, cool, Mike. We'll put it on the website. And here's the link, and it's pictures of other home gyms. I go to the website. There's, 400 pictures. And mine's, the very bottom. I was like, oh. Thanks.
You're like, oh, those all look really cool.
Yeah. No, I know. It was pretty cool. I started looking through some of them. Some of them were pretty awesome.
I'll bet. Yeah, you put a lot of money into this thing, but probably not like some people have.
Yeah,
I
don't even classify mine as a garage gym. It's a gym. Like, it's a training center.
Right.
So, because people have worked with, way less space, and, they have cars and all kinds of other shit they got to put in there. So I was actually fortunate to have all this extra room.
If you live in America, don't complain.
No, I'm not complaining.
Not you. I'm talking about everyone else.
Oh, yeah.
All right, so you got the games coming up here pretty soon.
Yep.
You got a couple sponsors that you probably want to thank.
Yes,
I
do.
Who's helping you out right now?
I want to start off with OPT for providing excellent programming and a great community. They've been a huge support for several years now, and just wanted to say thanks. I just recently signed with Nutriforce Sports. Check them out. They've got some awesome products, a huge selection of supplements, because I like to do my own individual dosing, the creatine and beta-alanine, depending on what type of session I just finished with. Not many other companies offer all of that. They've got, whey protein, BCAAs. They've got a pre-workout, all the different aminos you can add yourself, and which I was a big fan of. So I'm real happy to be on board with those guys. They were actually cool enough to send me a bunch of product before I made a decision, and they let me. They said, we want you to try it first and make sure you're happy. So I tried it for about a month, and liked what I saw. So I went ahead and signed with them, and very happy. They've been really cool so far. A lot of support there. Also picked up a food sponsorship, my first one ever, with a company. They're Boulder brands, but you might have heard them. They're Udi's and Glutino and Earth Balance. They make a bunch of gluten-free food, different options for people trying to look for different things in their diet. So if you're gluten intolerant, they make pizza crusts, hot dog buns, hamburger buns.
Oh,
I mean, they make everything.
My favorite one, you were really excited. We were inside your kitchen, and you were like, gluten-free Oreos.
Yep. I mean,
those are so good for
it's
you.
It's got that magic word in it.
Are they still called Oreos?
No, they're like gluten-free chocolate vanilla cream cookies or something. Okay. I don't remember. But that's made by Glutino.
Are they good?
I see, Glutino I've never really heard of. Udi's, I'm like a huge fan because I eat like 30 sandwiches a week and was so excited when I picked them up. Mm-hmm. And then they were also like, hey, we have this company or like a sister company, Glutino. And they sent me some of the coupons for their product as well, and I checked it out, and I was like, holy crap, they have some really good food.
Do you briefly want to justify why you eat that many sandwiches each week for people that don't know you or that are new to the show?
Because I'm training, like, a session per every sandwich I eat.
How many sessions a week do you train?
Right now, I'm at, let's say, 6 days on, 2 to 3 times a day, so... You know, 18 sessions a week.
Yeah, probably about 15 to 18
sessions a week.
You usually eat a sandwich post-workout?
Not every workout.
Not every workout.
Yeah,
But that's pretty common for you, though?
Yeah, I mean, I'll eat a lot of sandwiches, and mainly just because of convenience. And, like, I mean, when you're training that much, like, I've got to have variance, and I need calories. Like, it's hard to eat that clean and get that many calories in mm-hmm. without starting to add other stuff in.
It's pretty impossible.
For me, some people can eat, and gluten-free is the thing I like because it just doesn't give me any problems with my stomach. Like,
right.
If I go crush a half a loaf of Wonder Bread, I can tell a difference. Like, it bothers me.
I'll tell you right now, if I ate as many sandwiches as a McG eats a week, I would get fat. So, because I train 4 to 5 times a week.
Yeah.
All right, so my training volume is probably a quarter of what his is. So don't think this is just an excuse. Well, McGoldrick does it. I can do it.
What? He's not paleo.
Blasphemy.
No, I mean, I'll wither up.
Yeah.
Now in the off season, hell yeah, I'll go right back to paleo. I believe in that for healthy lifestyle. Like,
right.
That's how I feel great when I'm on that. But when the training volume is high, like, I absolutely can't do it. And I fall apart.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. All right, Doug.
Got anybody else you want to talk about?
Yeah. I don't want to leave anyone out.
Do you need a deodorant sponsorship? No. Do I need one? I want to thank... Body Science Compression, BSC, sent me some cool gear lately. They make some awesome compression gear. They've actually, Ben Kelly, BK Athletics, sent me out a pair of tights that help with my groin injury. I mean, these suckers are so tight that, like, I had to, like, jump to pull them on, but kept everything in nice. Don't snatch in them. Do not snatch in them. Yeah, I clipped myself pretty bad.
Did you?
Yeah. I was like, these feel awesome. And then I snatched, and I was like, took them right off. Went right back because I took them off. But everything else, they're fantastic.
Took them off, applied the ice.
But all their compression gear, I'm a big fan of. Their long tights, their arm sleeves, all the stuff works great. So I'm a big fan of their stuff as well.
Very cool.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right, very cool. I'm going to talk about that movement mastery program again real quick. Go to fitr.tv/products/movement, and there's a short video there kind of explaining what's in it. Again, as Mike said earlier, the two main parts of that program is there's the private Facebook group where you can submit videos, and then we can give you individual specific feedback on exactly how you can improve your technique. So if you don't have a coach or if your coach is really good at one aspect of CrossFit but maybe not very good at another aspect of CrossFit, if they have a gymnastics background or an endurance background and their weightlifting really isn't up to par, that's definitely our skill, is more on the weightlifting side of things. So if you're interested in improving your weightlifting technique and you don't have a coach for that, then you can take part in that movement mastery program. Mike.
That's what I wanted to talk about. I'm super excited about it.
I stole it. I took it.
Yeah. Just make sure to get over to barbellshrug.com, sign up for the newsletter. We got a lot of stuff going on. More and more things in the pipeline all the time.
Oh, go ahead.
Were you going to say something?
No, go ahead.
All right, okay. So anyways.
things are going on behind the camera.
I don't know what to say. You're distracting me. I'm easily distracted. anyways. So make sure you get over there. Follow us on Twitter at Barbell Shrugged. We're on Instagram and
you gonna mention? You going to mention Mike's T-shirt?
What about it?
Mike has a t-shirt coming
out. Mike has a t-shirt coming out.
You guys plug it. You're coming up with it.
I don't.
Okay, I'll do it then.
That the problem is I know that it's happening. I know what it looks like, but I've been left out of all the details.
Okay, we'll put a little teaser out
busted.
There.
Busted.
We're making a very cool t-shirt for Vermin Goldrick with a silverback gorilla on it. Because he reminds everyone of a silverback gorilla, and that'll be coming out here
actually,
pretty soon. So keep your eye out for that.
We should tell the story real quick. Real quick story. Yeah, the silverback thing came from the local newspaper wrote an article about Faction String Conditioning. They interviewed a bunch of us. They talked to me. They talked to everybody. Made us out to be like a bunch of caveman freaks. And so the woman that wrote the article, I guess she was in the gym one day. And saw McGoldrick. Maybe she didn't even see you. I don't know.
I don't know where she got half the stuff in the article from. But.
Yeah, the article was outrageous. She was definitely looking to make like paleo lifestyle very sensational.
The article she was like, or she was interviewing me, and she's like, so when you go to this cabin, how often do you stay outside and swim? And I was like, huh? She's like, you swim up the river and you catch all your food there, right? I was like, what do you think I am?
Yeah, but in the article, there was a part where she was like, and he has the pecs of a silverback gorilla.
Yeah, I was like, quote, unquote. I was like, bench press sucks.
Yeah, it was I remember reading the article and being like, oh, my gosh. I mean, if she got that much – that much stuff was skewed for that one article. I wonder, like, how much journalists just screw up things all the time. It was pretty funny.
Or if that's what outside people really think of us.
Yeah, they're like we
it's
think
totally accurate. That's we just can't see.
That's
it.
What Earth that's people what I, think. I call them Earth people.
Yeah. All right, guys. We have
barbell shrug.
So what? Oh, it's gonna be in barbell shrug. Okay. Yeah. So you can if you want to buy McG's T-shirt, it'll be
coming soon.
Well, it should be up by next week when this posts.
You can still go to the fundraiser page and email Ashley.
Yeah, so this is posting up next week, so I don't know if that's even going to – hopefully it's still up. I don't see why it wouldn't still be up. You can go to factionsc.com and order one of those shirts, and I think we're going to try and get them up on barbellshrug.com. If you go to barbellshrug.com, click on the shop, we'll have a place in there where you can buy the McGoldrick T-shirt. I know we just had a couple different versions of his shirt coming out, and that's why I was a little confused. I was fully aware we were making shirts. I promise. All right, guys. See you next week.
Thanks for having me.
Yep, thank you.